My name is Stefan Wintermeyer. I'm from Germany, and I'm probably going to steal the potatoes. So if somebody has a question, he'll get some other thing. About questions, please stop me anytime during the talk. It's going to be a bumpy ride. We are covering a lot of stuff. So if you have a question, just raise your hand and ask a question. So what's the impact of a slow website? This graph shows you the bounce rate changes during the loading time. So I want you to take home two things. One is, if your web page is slow, like if it takes like 15 seconds to load, 1 or 2 seconds improved loading time will not save you, because you're still in a very ugly area. You want to be here within the first 3 seconds. Why is that? These numbers show you how humans react on all sorts of user interfaces. That's the same if you are calling an elevator, or if you're at a traffic light, the same idea. We are here with software, but it's the same things in other areas of living. So everything below 100 milliseconds is instantly. And everything below 1 second is kind of okay. Once you go above 1 second, and it's getting slow. So the human mind tends to think about other stuff. Once you're above 10 seconds, everything's lost. So if you want to be in this good kind of area for web pages, like Google, you want to keep it under 1,000 milliseconds, which is a second. So what happens if your web page becomes slower, or if it becomes faster? Google made these experiments where they created special groups of their users who didn't know that they were invited to these groups, and slowed down their search for them. And we are not talking about 2 seconds or so, we are talking about 100 millisecond slowdown. So a normal thinking human would think that this is nothing. But still, with these small numbers, they saw an impact of the daily search of these groups. What is important to understand here is it took several weeks for this to happen. So if your web page becomes faster or it becomes slower, like tomorrow, you will not see an impact tomorrow afternoon. It'll take weeks to get this impact. That's the most important thing to remember, because otherwise you get disappointed and your clients. For most people, the mobile device became the number one device to go to the internet. That's very important to know, because you want to have the 1,000 milliseconds on a 3G network, because that's still the network which is most popular. What does that mean? Because of the TCP stack and stuff like DNS, the TCP connection, the handshake, et cetera, which all takes time, we end up with a frame of 400 milliseconds. So our server has 400 milliseconds time to render the HTML and to serve it to the client. And 400 milliseconds is not a lot, it's not a much. Some web performance problems we cannot fix with RAIDs. If you have a big JavaScript application and your web page loads, like, say, 3 MB of JavaScript initially, your web page will never be fast. We cannot solve this within RAIDs. So I'm talking about stuff we can solve for a typical RAIDs application. To understand that, we have to go through the very basics of web page rendering. So first, the client downloads a web page, which, for example, is an index.html file. Then it creates a DOM from that file. Then it downloads the CSS and creates a CSS DOM. Still nothing on the display yet. Then the browser downloads the needed JavaScript files. Still nothing on the display. And now, with everything in the browser, it renders the render tree and does the painting. So there's a lot of going on to actually render a web page on your display. This process takes at least 100 milliseconds. That's the minimum. So we have to subtract these 100 milliseconds from our 400 milliseconds we just calculated. So now we are talking about 300 milliseconds we have on the server. So how does a download with HTTP 1.1 over TCP happen? First, we have the three-way handshake. And then, because the inventors of TCP didn't know how much bandwidth the connections had, they said, OK, let's start with a small set of data, push that to the client, and see what happens. So in today's world, it's sending 10 TCP segments, it used to be this, which amounts to about 14 kilobit. So that's the very first package. And you see, the major problem here is latency. It's not bandwidth. Bandwidth is important if you want to use Netflix. It's not important if you want to browse a normal web page. Because now, after the first packet got transferred, the server says, OK, let's be bold, let's double it. And it sends something like 29 kb. And it said, again, it's the OK back, and then it doubles again. This doubling takes care until some error occurs. And then it goes one step back. And this mechanism, it's called TCP slow start, makes sure that the maximum bandwidth available gets used. But again, for us, for a typical web page, this means bandwidth is not our problem. Latency is. Latency means the distance, the network distance from the server to the browser. That's the reason why a web page, for example, if you have a server here, a web page is faster in the next room than it is in Sydney, Australia. That's just because of the latency between the server and the browser, not the bandwidth. This is, again, to show you the numbers, how much we are talking about here. HTTP2. Sorry for that. Cannot fix that. What it can do is it can push multiple files over the same connection. So in the past, we used multiple connections from a browser. So a browser said, OK, I know I have this bandwidth, but I know about TCP slow start and all the problems. So you know what? I just connect 6 or 8 times to a server and pull 6 or 8 files at the same time, depending on the browser. That was a good strategy for HTTP 1.1. It is not a good strategy anymore, because with HTTP 2, the protocol gives you the tools to send multiple files over the same connection. So how does it look like? It's always good to be to make new friends. So I looked at the web performance of the conference page. If you want to play with that, and it would be good to improve more pages, this tool here, that's an open source tool, and they have servers all over the world. So you can test your web page from a mobile phone in Sydney with an actual mobile phone in Sydney. So let's have a look. I tested it with a server and with a browser in Frankfurt over the 3G connection. And the start rendering is after 5.5 seconds. So that's the first time something happens on the display. Why is that? This is just to give you a basic idea. We are talking a lot of CSS files, JavaScript, etc., etc. If you remember the web page, one could argue that the same very web page doesn't need JavaScript as much as it used JavaScript. So, how does it feel? How does it feel? It doesn't. It's sorry. Different display here. We all know this situation where the browser starts to move after some time. So the page was more or less finished something between 20 seconds. We saw the first idea after some 6 seconds. Though that's not very good. But we are all cool, we all have ATE. So let's see how that works with ATE. Better numbers? Still kind of slow. And that's the best you can buy right now. Nobody has better connection than ATE. And of course, the second time it's faster because then it's in the cache, obviously. But you want to be fast on the first time, not on the second time. And to give you an idea, by coincidence, I have a fast web page. So my web page on the ATE connection starts rendering after 500 milliseconds. And to give you an idea how fast that is, this is a waterfall of that. That's a fast web page. Using the same technology as the other web page. So it's possible, you have to work for that. It's not free. So let's go through an example online web shop with Ruby. I guess everybody knows Rails. So this is our model view here. We have categories, we have products, we have users, we have reviews. So standard web shop. The product has a number of stars method, which just does the average of the ratings. So we can see how good or how bad a rating of a specific product is. I'm using, the Faker GAM to create the data. And this is the index view. Pretty standard, nothing too fancy. With a little bit of Twitter Bootstrap, it looks like this. But that's minimal work. So the only special thing is rendering these stars here. Now this takes about 500 milliseconds on my trusty laptop. So we are already way out of our 300 milliseconds range for a super simple page. Nothing fancy here, super simple. So again, we are hitting a problem here because we are all out of our range. The smart people are now saying, yeah, you use development mode. That's evil, anybody knows that. I would switch to production later. I just give you the numbers for development here to make it easier to see how much time we are losing on the database. So first, we create fragment caching, because fragment caching is the most powerful tool we have at our hands. For that, we have to activate fragment caching in the development mode. It is deactivated by default in development. And the first step is to fragment cache a single row. So this is our table, and we cache now one single row, each single row, obviously, in a separate cache. This is done by these two lines of code. So cache product do and the end. Everything else is done by Rails automatically. For this to work, we have to add a touch through true for the review model, because otherwise, whenever you add a review or change a review, you wouldn't have you would deliver an old cache. So you have to use touch there. So whoa, already below the 300 milliseconds, two lines of code. So that's a big improvement. The next step, what DHH always calls Russian door. So now we create a cache for the whole table too. So one cache for each line and one cache for the whole table. Again, two more lines of code. And that results in 53 milliseconds. Now we are at four lines of code and we already improved by tenfold. So that's very powerful. But you always have to think about the bottlenecks. And one of the bottlenecks in our application is this here. Why do we have to calculate the number of stars for the product every time we use it? It doesn't make any sense, because not every second we get a new review, not every second a review gets deleted. That's a very rare instance. So let's create a field for the product where we store the number of stars in the database and store that information whenever we create or destroy a review. So we have just we do this calculation just once and then store it in the database. And that's very powerful too. With these database improvements, we are down to 40 milliseconds. And now for everybody who loves to do it in production, it's 35 milliseconds in production. Warning, this is for the second view. Obviously, the first time it's always slow. So the first time actually will be slower than the 400 something milliseconds, 500 milliseconds, because we have to write the cache. That takes time too. So, and I hope you don't kill me for the next slide. In case you need more speed, you want to have a look at Phoenix. Because that very same page takes about 5 milliseconds on this computer and without cache. So there's quite a big difference. Let's go back to the wonderful world of Rails. We need to implement, or we need to go the whole 9 yards to get this thing the fastest way possible. And the next step is HTTP caching. The web browser and each proxy on the way to the server doesn't want to load the same resource multiple times. It doesn't make sense. So, therefore, etext and last modified fields were introduced and are used. What does it mean? The web browser says to the server, I fetched this file last week. I still have it in my cache. Can I use it? And then the web server says, yeah, of course you can. Nothing has changed. So, the web server answers with a 304 not modified. And this looks on the command line like this. This is a curl request. And here is the etext of this request. Different etext because we didn't send the same cookies. So Rails knows a different request. So if we want to use etext, we have to use fresh when in the controller. And then, again, we have to set the cookies here to tell Rails we are the same browser. We get the same etext for the same requests after. And that means we get a 304 not modified. And that not only means that the page is delivered faster to the user, but also that your server has less work, because your server only uses the controller. And the controller is fast compared to the view. So it's a win-win situation. And I have a slide for that. So, in case this is not good enough, the initial writing of the cache is a big performance problem. So, let's preheat the cache in the off-business hours. There's always time during the night where the servers are sitting around, don't knowing what to do. So, use that time to preheat your caches. Just don't be afraid of brute force. So the last step now, that's kind of the super fast web page. The fastest web page is a page where Nginx or Apache or whatever doesn't even call Rails. That happens, for example, for all the files in the public directory. If you have a 404, Rails is not triggered. Nginx delivers that static file from that directory. And there is a way to use it. We can use cache page, gem, to create these files in this directory. It used to be standard till Rails 4 point something. I forgot the exact number. It's not anymore, it's a separate gem, but you can still use it. And you cannot only store the static page, you can too gzip it right away. So that's work for the web server. And again, brute force is your friend. These are computers, not humans. The tricky part is, how do we delete old stuff? Because now we have a way to create new stuff which we can use, but sometimes a review will change, sometimes a product will change. We have to find a way to handle that. We can do that with this code here, where these files are deleted with after update or before destroyed. So now the smart people will say, yeah, that's okay if you don't have any sort of current user scenario. And it's the same thing. You just have to think a little bit harder. So you can use it, and I have an example here. Let's assume we have 10 million users of our web page. And I used this idea the first time in RailsConf in Portland, so I still have the same screenshot here. I said, let's see how big this page is. It's compressed 28K. So 28K times 10 million is 0.26 terabyte, which is nothing today. Hard drive space is cheap. You can use all sorts of fancy file system to reduce that even. At the end, you can handle 10 million users with a standard server. Nothing special here. Nginx will happily read the cookie to get the right page for the right user. You don't have to do the work within Rails. You can use Nginx to do that work. To do that is a lot of work. It's not an easy task. It's not like a week work. But it pays off with extreme fast web pages. So again, what is about HTTP 1.1 and HTTP 2.2? An easy rule, always use HTTP 2. Obviously, you have to support both for old clients, but you want to go HTTP 2 because just by that, you get an average of improvement of 20%. Just by, that's actually one word in the Nginx configuration. So that's an easy fix. What about the whole CDN problem? We learned all the years use CDNs to be fast. It's a complicated problem, but the long story short, is don't use CDNs anymore. Use your RAID server because you already have that pipe open. You don't want to open a second or a third pipe. Because of TCP slow start, you already have the biggest pipe possible right at that moment. Send all the files over that pipe. The only exception is if you are in the rare situation that you have clients all over the world. Like if you are Apple, this is not a good solution for you. Then you need a CDN. But for 99% of all web shops, they have very limited geographical client base. So they are tackling Europe or North America or whatever. So it's best to do that on the same server. And obviously by now, you should know that it's not a good idea to use a server in the US to deliver a web page here. So you want to have your server as near as possible to the browser. What about active storage? New fancy too. You want to use active storage to minimize image size. And that's a little bit trickier, because you want to deliver the best possible image for the given browser. For example, WebP. Right now, WebP gets used by Chrome and these browsers. Safari and Firefox are experimenting with it. So there are many browsers where you can use WebP, which delivers smaller images or smaller files with better quality, but not for all. But you can use active storage to deliver different images to all sorts of browsers. So that's very powerful too. The next question is always, should I use Apache or Nginx? And I really don't care. Both are very fine web servers. Use whatever you like. What about Proteus versus gzip? Proteus is kind of a new compression tool, and you want to use it. It gives you like a 5 to 8% additional compression of all files. And the positive thing is it uses less CPU power on the server. So again, a win-win scenario. You need less bandwidth and less CPU power. What about Heroku versus Bare Metal? I know Heroku is a very good idea to start a new project. It's very simple. It doesn't take long, etc. It's super easy. But it has never been known for being fast. So if you want to be within this 1 second lead, you want to go Bare Metal. And it'll be cheaper too. So that's a win-win. Now a couple of things HTML-wise. If you know what the next step will be, or if there's a highly chance what the next step will be for the user, you can use these tools to ask the browser to fetch stuff which the user needs in the future. So if you know that on your first web page there's an index of products and 50% of all users are clicking on the first product, it's an idea to fetch that page, so when the user clicks on that link, it's already in the browser. If you know that you probably need something in the future, it's always a good idea to set up the DNS already. So it saves you these 100 milliseconds for the DNS fetch. And that's a prefetch thing. And the cool thing is, if you set this up, you can tell Nginx to use this information to push stuff to the client, because HTTP2 has not only the possibility to get stuff, it can push resources too. Complicated in itself, not without any risk, because you always have the problem that you might be pushing something the client already has, so caching is a big issue there, but it's a powerful tool. But what is the most important tool? The most important tool is setting up a time budget. Because if you not set up time budget, your marketing department will come up next week, will tell you, why don't we add this fancy new widget here? Just two lines of JavaScript. Or, I'm not happy with this graphic. I want to have a better version of that. Just want to be more. This happens all the time. Every month, somebody in the company has a great idea to improve the web page. Normally, nobody thinks about the consequences web performance-wise. Therefore, you have to have an agreed time budget for the web performance on your page. Because then you can tell the marketing guys, okay, yeah, that's a great idea. Best idea I've seen in a long time. But we have a slight problem here, time budget-wise. This page now loads 10 seconds longer. So once you establish this rule, you can say, okay, if you really want to have this new feature, we have to drop some other features. And then this discussion starts. And that's okay. You can't drop other stuff. It's totally okay. It's just not okay to add new stuff every month without thinking about the consequences. So is web performance really so hard? Yes, it is. It's an uphill battle in most companies because most people don't realize what it means to have a fast web page and what it means to lose clients because of a slow web page. The bounce rate decreases 5% with every second of slower web page load. So you're losing clients with speed. If you want to dive into the technical aspect of the whole protocol, you want to buy this book, or it's online for free too as an HTML version from Ilya. It's kind of the web performance Bible. It's very good. If you want to dive more into the whole RADS 5.2 thing, by coincidence, I have a book which is available this week, starting this week. And because I forgot the potatoes, the first 10 people who write me an email will get a free ebook version if they promise me to write a review on Amazon. If you're interested in this whole topic, subscribe me on Twitter. I post stuff about web performance, about Rails, cute photos of my kids, general news about the world. And here's my email address. So, does anybody have questions?
Let's thank Stefan first. Let's start from that side. I noticed you had a question right here.
Thank you for the interesting talk. I have a question about eTech. What if users sign in to the web page, to the website, he get a web page, and then later sign out and sign in with a different login? Will he give a pre-cached page from the previous login?
You have to create a system where you say, okay, how long is this page good? And you might have to change the setup of your GUI for that. So obviously you need to use cookies to make this possible.
Yes.
And you normally people say, okay, this page is good for like 5 minutes. And then you know that after 5 minutes you have to reload it. But I see your point. You would have to change the workflow of the page to cover this. Most people use JavaScript for that. So they just do the login, log out via JavaScript and change the navigation bar, and normally we are only talking about navigation stuff, with JavaScript.
Thank you.
Okay, what do I hear? I give my microphone.
Hallo Stefan, danke für deine Rede. Wir alle sind the fraud does do here best. And my question, what do you think about the prognosis of HTTP2? Is it already widely used, and how quick the developers should go in this direction?
There's no question. Yeah? Don't ask me questions about HTTP2. Everybody should use it.
Okay,
there's no downside. There's no downside. It's like flowers everywhere.
Uh-huh. And thank unicorns.
You. Thank you.
One more here.
Hey, Stefan, thank you for your talk. If I understood you correctly, you advised that
could you speak
we should.
Up, please?
Sorry?
Could you speak up?
Yeah, sure. If I understood you correctly, you advised rather use your own server than CDN. Am I right?
CDN. In 99% of all cases, it's best to use your own server. The question is about CDNs, when to use CDNs and when not. Because you already have this connection open, and because HTTP2. Different story with HTTP 1.1. If you're using HTTP 1.1, CDNs are still good.
Yeah, but I thought that CDNs are optimized for, and they have like a lot of cache, and users which serve internet already have a lot of stuff from there, so they will just receive not modified response, and it will work right away, rather than download everything from scratch from my server. Do you think it might work, or it's still better to have a big bunch of files on my own server?
Sorry, I didn't get the question.
We already have on CDN a lot of user which serve internet
you're using a CDN right now. You already have terabytes of data there, and you are afraid of pushing this data on your server because you don't have the bandwidth.
Yeah, and I hope my users use the same files on other sites too. So it's very common.
So
you're
talking about something like a jQuery, JavaScript library.
They're very common libraries. So I believe users have
that's
already
them. That's a case by case situation. jQuery library is a good example because there are millions of different versions of that. So you cannot be sure which version is in the browser's cache. That's a very tricky thing. So if you are sure, for example, a good example would be a Google Ad JavaScript. You can use that from Google Ad, which you already do. That's perfect. But jQuery, it's already so tricky that I probably would use my own jQuery for my own server, because I don't know which one is in the cache.
And the last questions there.
Thanks, a lot of wisdom in your talk. So you advocate for the bare metal.
Yeah.
Do you have any recommendations for the provisioning tools? Like, would you use Docker or would you?
Whatever.
Else? What's your favorite?
My favorite. I'm old school.
I don't
use Docker. I don't use all this fancy stuff. I just.
FTP?
not that old, but I use our own set of handwritten tools to do that. And just for the last time, Phoenix has very cool features for that.
Oh.